Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity until this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelations given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated into the state of California in the year of 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and Canada in certain foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we teach by the true and correct names and title of the Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true and correct name for the Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in our physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5, that the Lord's many and God's many. But we now know each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This king, Elohim, is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. Among investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that will produce a sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and correct name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit. And in this state, he is inscrutable and incomprehensible and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on his chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh in pure spirit is not a cloud. He really chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Just as you see, this fiery cloud has been drawn to extend all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart abides within this cloud. In like manner, everything in the creation and the sum total of the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form within himself as Elohim. This is the Word, our Son. A super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelation. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A permanent understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface to the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up your one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof now that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First, is to help you find and know Yahweh Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second, is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, other so-called laws of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth, is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth, is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered unto the sons and children of Yahweh. Ninth, is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth, is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. We'll have a prayer this morning by Dr. Joe Williams, a selection of music, and a scripture lesson by Dr. Kenaway Kleisman.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Let's all bow our hearts in a moment of prayer. Oh, righteous Father Yahweh, we'd like to thank you once again for allowing us to assemble ourselves together one more time to learn more of your divine purpose and your pattern and plan of salvation. We ask that you, Father, as we sit and we stand here humbly before you, that you enter into our hearts and give us the desire and the inspiration to want to know you as you really are and actually exist. We ask that you touch our souls and eliminate our consciousness and fill every fiber of our soul with the gift of the Holy Spirit so that we may see and understand as we walk and sojourn through this earth plane that we understand who you are and who we are. We ask, Father, that you touch the souls of them that walk on this earth plane. You say, for those who do not know and those who have a desire to know, to come into this class and learn all they can in these last days. We ask, Father, that you continue to give this class strength and give us guidance and give us direction. Take that veil down that hangs in our consciousness. We ask all these blessings in our own begotten Father's name, Yahshua Messiah. Let us all say,
hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible revised by A.B. Trina of the Scripture Research Association and reprinted by Yahshua Promotions. Hebrew, the 8th. Now the things which we have spoken, this is the psalm. We have such a high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. A minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle, which Yahweh pitched and not man. For every high priest is ordained to offer gifts and sacrifices. Wherefore, it is a necessity that this man have something also to offer. For if he were on earth, he should not be a priest, seeing that there are priests that offer gifts according to the law, who serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things, as Moses was admonished of Elohim when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, saith he, that I make all things according to the pattern showed to thee in the mount. But now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is a mediator of a better covenant, which was established among better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. For finding fault with it, he saith, behold, the day is come, saith Yahweh, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, saith Yahweh. But this is a covenant that I will make. Listen, it's very disturbing, you're talking in the background. But listen, this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith Yahweh. I will put my laws into their mind and write them in their hearts, and I will be to them their Elohim, and they shall be to me my people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know ye Yahweh, for all shall know me from the least to the greatest. For I will be merciful to their unpleasantness and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. In that he saith the new covenant, he hath made the first old. Now that which decayeth and waxeth old is ready to vanish away. That was Hebrews the 8th, for the salt say.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Before our first speaker, I would like to acknowledge our guest from LA, Dr. Sean Thompson. And this Sunday, we will continue with our winter series of lectures. And this topic is explanation of the elementary chart. And our first teacher this morning will be Dr. Will Williams.
morning, class.
Good morning.
Good to see you here. Good to be here. And boy, before I get into it, I just gotta say, man, sometimes I wish I was a choir director again. Because the music, see, we have to cut the tape off for the music part, but we need to do something about that. Maybe we can get permission or something, you know, I don't know, man, because that's, I think that's kind of missing, you know, when we do our podcasts like that, because that's, man, it's just, even Dr. Kelly said, don't cut the prayer, don't cut the music, you know, not so much that we believe in it, but that's for those that come in and, you know, make them feel comfortable and that kind of thing. That's why we go through these, you know, that kind of stuff, you know. But this is our time of the year, the end of the year, again. And at the end of the year is always the beginning of our winter series of lectures that we've done for, gosh, how long? 13, 14 years or so. And generally, what we do, we get different topics between, we start on the first day of winter. You know, that's, you know, the Sunday's closest to that. And we generally get topics that we, you know, kind of focus in on, and we encourage others to, you know, to get a topic, you know, something about the charts, or something about the purpose of Yahweh, and expound upon it. Generally, when we started off with two basic lectures we generally start off with. Last week, we started off with the true birthday of the Messiah, talking about that. And the second week, we usually do the elementary chart. And then after that, it could be whatever, okay? But that's how we generally do that, and that's the way we've done that for many years. So I've done this lecture quite a few times, and I've recorded it so I can always go back and look at what I've done over the years, you know, and compare and whatever, and, you know, what I could say different or better or include or exclude, or because you're not gonna get through this whole thing. I'll just tell you right up front, not in a 2-hour session, okay? But the best you can do, and this is what I try to focus in on, if I could just give just a mini testimony, personal testimony. For me personally, the thing that drew me to this class was a book. That book was called Elohim, the Archetype, Origin, and Pattern of the Universe. And it was written by a man named Henry Clifford Kinley. And I read this book. Now, the class, I had heard of the class. And what little I heard of the class, I'll just tell you quite honestly, didn't appeal to me. In fact, I remember my phrase about it, said it sounded like a new kind of Jesus freak to me. That's what I thought. Because I knew people that were personally in it, and they were trying to talk to me about it. Get away. But then I read this, I came across this book, and I read it. And, you know, and that made all the difference, okay, because of what he talked about, you know, what this man talked about. And he talked about this divine pattern of the universe, okay. Well, this is a representation of it. The real divine pattern is Elohim himself.
That's right. Right.
Okay. But see, but he showed that to understand him, he gave a divine pattern to mankind by which you can look at to ascertain who, what, where, how, and why he is. Okay? Now, I'd like to get from this book, and see, and I know a lot of people will say, oh, you know, a lot of people poo-poo the textbook. You know, now I can't even hear myself.
I got you. Okay. Talking.
All right, man. And yeah, because and over the years, people have said this, that, and the other about it. But see, but I'm gonna let the book defend itself. See, because people say, well, the book was written for the world, or it doesn't mean this, or it doesn't mean that, you know. But I'll let the book defend itself. If you would get the flyleaf, the flyleaf of a book, the fly, you know what the flyleaf is. If not, Joe will tell you. And I want the last paragraph.
This work, in short, sets up Elohim as the archetype pattern of the universe as he revealed himself to Moses and confirmed by the Apostle John's and Dr. Kinley's visions, and is further confirmed by the cosmographical structure and operation of the universe, the Holy Scriptures, Law, and the Prophets. the historical events and actions of mankind, and lastly, but not least, by the physical makeup and operation of man's own physical body and mind to the extent that nothing is excluded from its all-encompassing bounds. It proves that everything and every event of this universe is correlated and leaves no doubt that Yahweh exists and is the creator and the eternally abiding spirit that pervades and embodies the universe in its totality. Everyone who reads and understands this work will be taken captive against his own will.
Read that again.
Yes, right.
Everyone who reads
and understands this work.
And understands this work. Read.
Will be taken captive. Against his own will.
Against his own will.
And will henceforth be unshakable and firmly rooted in a profound knowledge of his eternal creator, and will definitely live in glorification throughout eternity with others who hear his voice from heaven.
I didn't write that. You know who wrote that? This man right here. Focus right in on that. That name right there. He wrote that. And I believe him. And it still stands.
Right.
No matter what anybody says or do. This pattern, now I'll read something else. Fourth volume, page 2. Just to accentuate that, and then we'll move on.
Fourth volume, page 2. Well, out of my 40 years of personal experience.
This is the same man who's writing here, Henry Clifford Kinley. This is what he wrote.
Plus an intensified and inexhaustible scientific and philosophical research, or since Yahweh showed me the divine vision with the revealed interpretation of its meaning, I have not found one so-called religious faith that fully realizes that Yahweh Elohim is a universal spirit pattern with an immutable spirit law embodied within himself, by which he established the perfection of the operation of his revealed eternal purpose. Or in other words, Yahweh declared the end from the beginning. The same universal spirit pattern with the spirit law embodied therein was revealed to Moses, the prophets and apostles by his spirit, which is sufficient to reconcile the world to the one and only true Yahweh and the only one and only true way to the universal truth, righteousness, joy, and perfect peace. Frankly and honestly speaking, the true knowledge and understanding of the divine pattern and its unerring spirit law operation, manifesting Yahweh and his purpose through every cosmic phase of nature and throughout the dispensations and ages, is the supreme test of every human creature's personal experience, understanding, and knowledge of Yahweh and his kingdom. There is no personal...
That's it. Now, that's what Henry Clifford Kinley wrote about this pattern. Looking at this pattern, understand what this represents. Universal spirit law embedded in a universal spirit pattern, which is operating and permeating through everything. And he said that was the supreme test. In other words, in so many words, that's your salvation. Now, that's what he said salvation was. He didn't say anything else. He said that's was your supreme test. See? Now, this elementary chart, because he received a stupefying panoramic vision, June 6, 1931. He didn't jump up and just drew it out. In fact, it kind of he didn't know what to do at first, to be honest with you. Go to the lake, fishing with a little dog or whatever. And just wondered how could he convey that which he saw in a vision, in a revelation. And it came upon him, you know, to make illustrations. I was told he made an oil illustration first, and it seeped on the wall. So then he put it on a bench, and made another one, and put it on a bed sheet, which is still exists in Los Angeles class. And this is an elementary chart, and in the textbook that he wrote, he writes a section about this chart, and it's a threefold It's in three tiers, put it like that. The official name of this chart is called a chart on pattern or plan of salvation. And it's basically a three-tier chart. Here you have the circles up here. That's the first tier. And this is representative of the ages and dispensations. In fact, see, many of the charts that you see here are drawn out from this chart, because this was the first one. See, this is another tier here, you know, threefold, and this is one tier here. And this is another tier, one, two, three, four, another tier here. Okay? But now this is the first chart he made, and as I said, other charts were drawn out of that. The first one that was drawn from that was this Moses chart, see, because it's here on the elementary chart. Another chart that came out was up here, we talk about these circles, the ages and dispensations chart. It's the same thing as those circles, the only difference is it's just got numbers, that's right, as written out, but it's the same thing. See, then another chart here, man made an image of Elohim by the pattern of the tabernacle. And then we have cardinal ordinances chart. That's drawn, all of these charts are drawn out of this because it's showing you here, Yahshua, see, because Yahshua's dying on the cross, he's fulfilling all of that. And see here with Moses, we see Moses is getting the law from here. So see all of these things, you know, these charts are drawn from that elementary chart. Even this chart, which is the last chart Dr. Kelly made, he and Dr. Gross. And he used to call it the map. See, most, a lot of people call it the Daniel chart. And that was because Lee Warren wrote a book called the Third World War Doctrine, and he used this chart heavily, and so he renamed it the Daniel chart. But the old folks, you know, they still call it the map, because it is. I mean, you see here is a map of the old Roman Empire here, this little reddish area, stuff like that. And then you got the two plates here, regeneration of the first Adam, regeneration of the second, and this is going from right to left, mimicking the arc of history, you know, with Yahshua fulfilling here, okay? Maybe we'll get into that later, another time. But I'm just showing you all these charts that are drawn from that, including the 40-plate chart, because that's germane to all of this. It's a more expanded. It's really the vision, you know, expanded in its completion. This is just your building blocks. Here, this is like if you were in kindergarten, you had little blocks like, like, right, like, you know, had letters on it and numbers, you know, you play with it, you know, that's all this is. And Dr. Kelly would even tell you this too. These charts are limited in scope and in depth. But because our eyes are the highest sense we have, and you just look at it, you know, you never come in here before, you walk through the door and you're like, whoa, you know, you're already assaulted by colors and images, and you know, it gets your attention. It's designed to do that. It gets your attention. Of course, some people have had various descriptions. I've heard people say it looks like scrambled eggs and stuff like that. Never looked like scrambled eggs to me. You know, especially when I saw, because see, the first time I ever came to a class, it was a workshop. Well, it was a college meeting, I put it like that. That was in St. Louis with Bill Farley, and it was in his house, and he had this Moses chart up. And I could recognize it off the bat. It was a map, because it said Egypt right here. Well, then there's a Sinai. I came in like, I mean, you know, I know a little bit about geography. You know, I mean, I looked at it and said, this is a map, and I'm like, it's kind of, you know, weird map, because I know, it ain't gonna, you know, because I know the wilderness of Sinai and Canaan, you know, that's east of Egypt, you know, I knew that geographically, you know. But this is showing you principles.
That's right.
See, I think there's a story, wasn't it, Wilbur Trainer, which was it, where, you know, he said that something very similar to Dr. Kelly, that, well, it's not the way it really is, you know, because, you know, it looks like it's going north, you know, and all of this is east of, you know, and I think Dr. Kelly simply just said to him, well, would you kindly come up here and point out to me where it's East Hill and West Hill at on this chart, on this chart. You know, I think they're kind of kept him quiet after that. Because see, the whole thing is this is not, it is a map as far as direction, pointing the way, but it's not geographical in that sense. But it is a map that does show you how to approach, how to get to Yahweh in a spiritual sense. That's what it's designed to do. Okay? And Dr. Kinley outlines it in his textbook. You see a textbook, Dr. Sidebar, since you're right nearby. Let's see here, it was 120. Page 126, volume 1. The number 7 denotes perfection. See, and as you can see, he has the migratory pattern plate here, and he has the tabernacle pattern plate here. There are 7 steps in the tabernacle pattern, which corresponds to 7 steps in the migratory tract. What he is showing you is simply this. If you know the 7 correlations between these 2 plates, then you can explain and unlock every plate, every chart in this room. Because this is the basis for everything that you're looking at in here. The correlations, the comparisons, or however you want to put it, comparative analysis, if you will. But that's basically it. 7 correlations. That's pretty much all you need to learn and understand about what this plate is, these tents, tabernacle, and the migratory tract, and you can explain every plate on these charts. It's really that simple. That's why it's here like this. That's why this, these 2 plates are in the center of all of this. This is where it emanates from. Like Captain Kirk said, this is the prime directive. This is what, this is it. You learn this, you learn them all. A lot of you don't believe that. I challenge them to refute it. Because we have talked about every chart in this room, haven't we not?
Mm-hmm.
In detail, we have the videos to prove it. Just simply go to our YouTube page and watch them. See? Why? Because this is what our founder wanted us to do. This is why he set up a school of research, a school of instruction. He could have just as easily walked down the aisle and said, hey, receive ye the Holy Spirit, next. Receive ye the Holy Spirit, next. Move along here, we've got a line. But he didn't do that. Nope, did not do that. He set up a school. He drew charts. He wrote 2 books. And he said this, he said, look, I drew 7 charts and wrote 2 books. And I've given you enough to save you. That's all, that's it, I've given you enough. A lot of people don't think so. That's why you come up with a lot of other things. But if you take the time and go through these 7 charts and 2 books, you will realize and find out, oh yeah, he gave you enough. He gave you more than enough. If you really understand what he gave you. The only reason why people go and start other things is because they don't understand what he gave.
Mm-hmm.
That's the only reason. And it's evident. You see it. But we're the crazy ones, right? We're the ones who don't know. See? Because we dare to be obedient to what he preached. Come on, Dr. Kinley. As evident by his book and his transcripts and his own. It's all there. The evidence is, it's overwhelming. Now, if you want to deny it, that's on you. But me, I made my choice. And I stick with what Dr. Kinley preached. He preached this pattern. And that's what I'm going to stick with. And that's what I'm going to talk about. All right? Now, this pattern, go back to the scripture lesson, 8:5. That's the reason why I couldn't think of nothing else. I mean, it's just, that was the only reason why you had that there, just for that one passage.
Hebrews 8:5. We serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things,
mm-hmm.
as Moses was admonished of Elohim when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, saith he, that thou make all things according to the pattern shown to thee in the mount.
See, make all things according to the pattern shown to thee in the mount, and that this pattern is a pattern of heavenly things. In other words, to understand something about heavenly things, you have to understand about this pattern. The one that came, that was brought down into the physical. Because that's where we're at. To understand heavenly things. Let me just go throw this in. Romans 1, 19 and 20. And then we'll go somewhere.
Romans 1, 19 and 20. Because that which may be known of Yahweh mm-hmm. is manifest in them. Mm-hmm. For Yahweh has showed it unto them. Mm-hmm. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world mm-hmm. are clearly seen, mm-hmm. being understood by the things that are made, mm-hmm. even his eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
Okay, now you can go a lot of ways with that, but I'll just keep it simple in this sense. See, it's supernal nature, these threefold.
Right.
It's the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. Now, his eternal power. That is the power of transmutation.
Right.
Say what? Yes. The power to, because what? That's what he does. He's transmuting it into all these ages. Here it is, the beginning. He's transmuting into these ages. And then ends. The dissolution of those ages. And then a new set of ages transmutes into a new set of ages. Matter is spirit materialized. How did that come about? It came about by transmutation. That is his eternal power. That is the power that he exercises from eternity to eternity without fail.
You want me to read the description of transmutation?
Of what?
Of transmutation.
Why not?
Transmutation. The action of changing or state of being changed into another form.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now since you did that, now I got to do this. Malachi 3 and 6. You may as well just go on and just fill that one out.
Malachi 3 and 6.
Mm-hmm.
For I am Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
I change not.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, ye sons of Jacob are not. Consume.
Now, here's what that means. Yahweh was spirit. It would appear that he's changing from pure spirit into incorporeal state, shape, and form, and then changing into the physical creation. And I'm here to tell you that is not so. Yahweh ain't changing into nothing. Yahweh has never, ever changed into anything.
Mm-hmm.
Period. Why? He said, I don't change. Because see, what you're looking at here is not him changing into this. This is spirit materialized.
Right.
In other words, what you see here manifest, the sun, the moon, the stars, being manifested in the physical.
Come on.
Because it already existed in the abstract.
That's right.
That's why we can say Yahweh is all in all.
Right.
That's why we can say Yahweh is terminus ad quem. Terminus ad quo, the limits and the bounds. Because everything is here. It exists here. The sun, the moon, the stars, you, everything exists here. All Yahweh did was simply made it manifest.
Very good.
That's all he did. He didn't change it into none of this.
That's right.
He just made it manifest. Otherwise, that scripture would be a lie.
Right.
See, this is the things that our founder explained. You take the time to look and learn. See, now back to this pattern. See, it's just us chickens up in here. Moses was given this pattern, and we just saw in the text where our founder outlined that there are seven steps in this pattern. The first step is the gate, which corresponds to the door of the Israelites' houses down here in Egypt during the Passover. Altar of sin and sacrifice with the four horns of blood on it. See, second step, which represents the door, where the Israelites, when they sacrificed that lamb, had to put four points of blood on it. Top, the lintel of the door, the two side posts, and a basin at the bottom. Four points of blood, just like there were four points of blood here. See, Here you have the brazen altar, or the brazen laver of water, third step, where the priests, you know, wash the animals and themselves, right? A cleansing. Cleansing, the principle, also is a principle of an immersion or baptism. Over here, the Red Sea, the Israelites, when they came out, they went through, you know, they came to the body of the Red Sea, the divided waters of the Red Sea, which opened up like a door to them, which would be like the fourth step of the pattern, because they followed this phenomenal cloud through that, which is the door here, which the high priest had to be anointed with the cup of holy anointing oil at the door, which is the fourth step, which is likened to that cloud here that the Israelites were led out of Egypt by. And then in the fifth step, here, this would be the wilderness of Sinai, which just corresponds to the holy place here in the tabernacle with the seven-branch lampstand for light, the table of shewbread for sustenance for the high priestess and the two low priests, the golden altar of incense, which was a mediator or intercession because the incense here would mask the burnt flesh of the sacrifices so that it would be a sweet-smelling savor unto Yahweh. Now you can get as elaborate as you like, but what we're looking for is principles. I'll reiterate, go back down here. A death, a burial, a resurrection, or a blood, water, spirit, light, bread, intercession. This is in the holy place. Remember, these principles are going to be applicable to all of these points.
That's right.
So I come over here to this holy place. I look for the light, the bread, the intercessor. As we said, let's read this. Exodus, what about the cloud? Is that 12th chapter? Mm-hmm. Cloud by day and
13:21.
Thank you.
13:21. Exodus 13:21. And Yahweh went before them by day in a pillar of a cloud to lead them the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light to go by day and night.
All right, so there was light out here. See, that corresponds to the light here in the tabernacle. They had manna from heaven that was given to them. I'm just cutting it up because I need to get to some other place here. But I want to at least lay down this principle. See, manna was given them from heaven, which they used to make bread with, just like here's bread over here. The intercessor, see Moses, he was full of the Holy Spirit. He would go up to Mount, see, he was the mediator, so to speak, the Holy Spirit in him, the mediator between Yahweh and men through the covenant they made, you know, he made with them. He was the one that Joshua ministered unto, intercessor, just like there was an intercessor here, or mediated the stench of flesh. Because Moses, come over here. See this little white tent here? See, Moses could go into the meeting tent of the congregation. This is where Joshua, son of Nun, lived at. See, Moses was the only one that could go up in there. And really, when you understand it, when Moses came down the trip, the third trip, which is the second time he saw the vision, his face glowed. People couldn't look at him. The only one that could look at him face to face was Joshua, son of Nun. Because he could go into the meeting tent of the congregation and take off the veil and shine as bright as the sun. And Joshua would say, hey, what's going on, buddy? And not blink an eye. Because the sun is within the sun. You know what I'm saying? Now, here, next, we have this veil, the second departmental veil, blue, purple, and scarlet, that separated this sanctuary or the holy place from the most holy place. That's likened to the Jordan River. See, the Jordan River, see, separated the wilderness of Sinai from Canaan's land. And it divided as well so that the Israelites could go over. I need the veil in the temple. Is that Matthew 27 something? That Joshua's death of the veil? Yeah. 27:51 maybe. I'm making a wild guess, but I'm thinking I'm close.
Yeah, you're close.
27, Matthew 27:51. And behold, the veil of the temple.
Go a verse before that.
50. Yahshua, when he cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the spirit.
Now, Yahshua yielded up the spirit. In other words, he died. I'm talking about the flesh, the physical body of God. He died. Or he gave up the ghost, so to speak. And read.
And behold, The veil of the temple was torn in twain from the top to the bottom.
And the veil of the temple was torn in twain, okay? Why? Because it echoed Yahshua's physical body being rent in twain. That's why, draw a line. Just come over here. That's why you see this illustration. Here, zoom in on this. See this veil here, how jagged and ragged it is?
Right.
Come on,
it's showing you that your veil has to be rent in twain.
Very right. Good.
Okay. See? Your veil has to be rent in twain. See, why? So that, see, look, you're made body, soul, spirit. When that is rent in twain, then your soul can look into the most holy place, or the spirit and the flesh of the Shekinah can be made unto you, can be revealed to you, and you will see Elohim for yourself within you. See, that's the thing that a lot of people, that probably people say it, not going to tell my mind.
Yeah.
You know, this thing about the Holy Spirit, you know, you got to put the Holy Spirit in, that is such a crock.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll say it again, it is a crock. It's no such thing, you know, about, well, the Holy Spirit got to be put in you, you know. No, it don't. Uh-uh. Yahweh don't have to jump from one thing to another. Name one thing in the universe. Anybody here, name one thing in the universe that Yahweh is not in. Because he's the law of the spirit that animates everything. So just kindly name me one thing Yahweh is not in. Anything. I'd like to hear it. Anything. Oh, he's not in that. Oh, he's not in that. Oh, well, let me go jump in that. No, he's there. Because David said, where I go, you know, if I go to the highest mountaintop, you're there. If I go down to the depths of the ocean down there, you're there. Name some places where Yahweh's not.
Right.
But Yahweh's not in Donald Trump. Oh, yes, he is.
Yeah.
He's in Donald Trump. Who do you think put Donald Trump in office?
Mm-hmm.
You don't think Yahweh did that? Hell, Yahweh set Pharaoh up. What are you trying to tell me? Yahweh set all these guys up. Nebuchadnezzar, Cyrus, Alexander the Great, Julius Caesar, Augustus. He set all them people up.
Mm-hmm.
What are you trying to tell me? He didn't quit all of a sudden? Oh, no, he don't do those kind of things no more. We just read the scripture, our Yahweh changed not.
You're ready.
Okay. Where are we at? Oh, there, the veil. Yeah. So that veil was written twin just like the Jordan River. It divided for the Israelites when they had to cross over. And then here we have Canaan's land. That's the sixth step. See, we call it, also call this the veil of the flesh. And here's the seventh step. I'll start here. Ark of the Covenant. Two angels on top of a mercy seat. That cloud that led the Israelites out of Egypt. See, that cloud sat between the two wings, the two archangels. And see, in the tables of stone that Moses was, he broke the first tables of stone. He had to bring up his own to be written in, and they were put in here. Why? Because, see, this represents the law that governed the whole body of Israel. So it's representative of spirit law, or the authority. Come on, line. Here's Solomon's temple up here, and he built that temple. And this temple was built on Mount Moriah, which is a, if you ever seen it, it's a mountain of gradation, you know, like one level and then another level and another, and that's how this was built. This was threefold as well. This was a porch, a sanctuary, and an oracle. And see, when you looked at it, it looked like a man sitting on a throne. Why? When you read about it, I don't know if you can find the scripture, I don't have time, but there were two chapters. Two big giant brass chapiters that you had to walk through for the porch, and they looked like giant legs. They even had names. One chapiter was called Boaz, and the other one was called Jachin. And together, when you translate it, means in his strength. As you can see. And see, in the top was a dome of beaten gold that would reflect the sunlight. And so when you look at it at certain angles, that's, you know, you would be like a beacon. Even at night, like on a full moon, you would see, you know, they were like, wow, what's that flash of light? You know, oh, that's Yahweh up. That's Yahweh's house at Jerusalem. Why? Draw a line.
Right.
On the Day of Atonement, the high priest had to come up here. See, with 21 flicks of blood, and after that 21 flicks of blood, he would see the flash of the Shekinah up here, or a vision of Elohim, or that flash of light in his consciousness. Elohim. See, that's See, that vision of everyone, and come out of this, come on. You know, see what I'm saying? It's the same thing. See, all these things are co-related. Once you understand the correlations between the two places, then you can correlate everything up here. And the reason why Dr. Kinley did that, because he wanted you to get the idea and understand how the pattern worked, the repetitiousness of it, so that you can take this same pattern and apply it to yourself. Because just as I could pull up a plate here, we got Adam. He's going by the pattern. Hey, so are you. Once you understand how Adam's going by the pattern, and how Noah's going by the pattern, and how Moses going by the pattern, and how Abraham's going by the pattern, and all these other folks going by the pattern, you can just keep going and say, oh, wait a minute. How am I going by the pattern? Oh, now you got the tools, and you'll see how this works. Something else I need to bring up. It's in Genesis. I need Jacob's ladder.
Genesis 28 and 13.
Now let's just look at this and just understand what Jacob is looking at. Go ahead.
Genesis 28 and 13. And behold, Yahweh's, go to 12. And he dreamed.
Now go above that.
10. And Jacob went out from Beersheba and went toward Haran.
Mm-hmm.
And he lighted upon a certain place and mm-hmm. tarried there all night
mm-hmm.
because the sun was set.
Okay, now the sun is set, sun's going down. All right, and darkness is descending on the face of the earth. Read.
He took of the stones that place
uh-huh.
and put them down for his pillows.
Now he lay, put them down for the pillows, and then he's going to go to sleep. Sleep is a type of death. Read.
And lay down in that place to sleep.
And he went to sleep, and there's a death. Read.
And he dreamed.
Now he dreamed. He's immersed in a dream. Read.
And behold, the ladder set up on the earth.
Now he sees a ladder set up on the earth.
And the top of it reached to the heavens.
And the top reached to the heavens.
And behold,
mm-hmm.
the angels of Elohim ascending,
ascending and descending
on it.
This is a ladder. Look, we just got through saying there's seven steps in here, right? Here's a stick. Pretend this is a wooden rung on a ladder. See, here's one rung, two rungs, three rungs, four rungs, five rungs, six rungs, seven rungs.
Got it. Cool.
This is what, and see, he's immersed in a dream, and he's elevated, which is a type of resurrection spirit. Jacob, he is elevated in the spirit, because now he sees who's sitting at the top of this. Read.
13. And behold, Yahweh stood above it and said, I am Yahweh, the El of Abraham, thy father, the El of Isaac. The land whereon thou liest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed.
All right, that's good enough. Now, the principle I'm just trying to draw out from this is simply this. These plates descend, or they ascend. Some cases, they do both.
Mm-hmm.
This is the Adamic transgression plate. This is a descending plate. Why do I say that? Well, just look at, if I was reading a comic strip, or better yet, these illustrations are the stories of the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
So all you gotta do is look at the Bible and see where you talk. Okay, we're reading about Adam and Eve and Lucifer in the garden. Well, that starts up here. And then the transgression happens, and they're busted, and here's the angel kicking them out. And now here they are out here, you know, working by the sweat of his face, you know, and they got kids. So the story starts up here. And he sends down. And then if I was to come over here with Noah, this would be an ascending plate. Why? Because, well, which happened first? Noah going out warning the wicked, or Noah after the flood, you know, with the covenant of Elohim and the rainbow. You understand my point? It's not that hard. Once you understand the system. Now, the thing is, we said there were seven steps, so we can just go by the pattern. We start up here with Adam and Eve.
Mm-hmm.
They're up here in the garden. Get Genesis. I want the day. That's what I want. Have those mouths, Joe. I want the day. It's either, well, I don't know what version you use. It's either the second chapter or 1 and 28 or
2 and 1.
Genesis 2 and 1, in the Pauline Bible.
Oh, okay.
Genesis 2 and 1. These are the origins of the heavens and of the earth, whom they were created in the day that Yahweh Elohim made the earth and the heavens. And every plant of the field.
Okay, that's good enough. And they were created in the day. See? It didn't say that, right?
Yeah, she said.
Okay. In the day. And so, in other words, it's like this. The sun, see, when Adam. Yeah. Read my mind.
Which one?
11. 11 to 12. Let me just wait. Let me just bring them up. 11, 12. Yeah, this is 11, 12, and this would be 15, because this is what comes next after this. Here's the man Adam. He's created from the dust of the earth. Right? And Elohim breathed on him the breath of life. Let's just understand this. Yahweh didn't just walk up to him and just say,
there you go.
Now, I know Yahshua did that in fulfillment down here with his disciples. You know,
right.
He didn't do that.
Yeah.
He breathed on them. You know, receive the Holy Spirit. He didn't do that. Can't deny that. But he did that because that was something visible they could look at so that they could relate to. But back here, there's no such thing as artificial, what do you call it, CPR? I didn't go to class.
Oh, yeah.
Something. Yeah, No, this is what happens. See, look, this is body, soul, because you got the vision between body and soul. He made Adam a living soul. In other words, see, oh boy, why did I do this? But anyway, I'm here. And then here's the spirit law. See, the division between soul and spirit. The spirit law that's animating the man Adam. In other words, I'll put it to you like this. Oh boy. 2 Corinthians 12 chapter. This is a really weird way for me to explain this chart. but I hope it's relevant.
Well, 2 Corinthians 12. It is not expedient for me doubtless to glory.
Mm-hmm.
It will come to visions and revelations of Yahweh.
Read.
I knew a man of the Messiah more than 14 years ago. Whether in the body I cannot tell,
mm-hmm.
or whether out of the body I cannot tell. Yahweh knoweth.
Mm-hmm.
Such a one caught up to the third heaven.
The third heaven. Now if there's a third, keep reading.
And I knew such a man, whether in the body or out of the body I cannot tell. Yahweh knoweth. That he was caught up into glory and heard unspeakable words which is not possible for a man to utter.
All right. Now, Paul talks about a third heaven. Now, if there's a third heaven, that would preclude there's a first and a second.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Right.
Over here. As we said, the migratory trek. I didn't say it, I'll say it now. The migratory trek is Egypt, Wilderness of Sinai, Canaan's land, represents the greater and more perfect sanctuary, which is the universe. How so? Well, Egypt here represents the physical creation. The wilderness of Sinai represents the angelic creation. Canaan's land represents spirit law, universal spirit law, both of which emanate from spirit law. The physical creation and the angelic creation emanates from spirit law.
That's right.
Yeah.
I had to do that so that I could say this. You are body, soul, and spirit. Your body and soul emanates from the spirit that is within you, which is Elohim, which is spirit law, which is the law of the spirit, which is universal spirit law, whatever you want to say, and I'm even going to say it even further, it is Yahshua.
Right.
But here's the problem with you. Before this happens, there's a veil up.
That's
you don't
right.
know a damn thing.
That's right.
You're a natural brute beast.
Right.
You are thoroughly hidden
yes.
from Yahweh. Uh-huh. Yahweh is not latent in you. You are the one that's latent. You are the one that's dead. But this has to be rent up in twain. And Yahshua has to reveal himself to you. The flesh Shekinah. He has to reveal himself. That's why you come in here. That's what we do. Our job. We rip veils. That's what we do. Renting veils are us. That's what we do. Let me tell you something. Any human beings that come in here and sit down for 2 hours and truly, truly listen to this gospel being expounded upon, those veils are going to be rent. Bar none. The difference is simply this. When they get up and leave out of this room, what will they do with it? Will they leave the veils unrent, or will they sew them back up?
See.
I've seen both. Mm-hmm. You know? See, that's the thing. This is what our founder taught. This is the record he left. See? That's what's happening here. Here's Adam, this body. He made a living soul. What is a soul anyway? A soul is nothing but these attributes. In part, made manifested in a physical body. Controlled with unerring accuracy by spirit law. And that's an every man, including Donald Trump. Now, how about that? Now, if someone says, well, does that mean Donald Trump has the Holy Spirit? Hell no. Or anybody else for that matter who don't know, because to have the Holy Spirit, the veil's gotta be, you gotta be conscious of that. But if you ain't conscious of it, you're a natural group beast, and guess what? You'll still be bound for the lake. You still qualify for it, because you don't know. You are unaware. You are ignorant. And then here we got the man here. He's laid down. And an incision is made. The bone, the rib, and the womb is taken out of the man. And a womb man is brought to him.
Right.
And here we have the unity of the masculine and feminine sexes. See? The representative of Yahshua and his bride. See? And they were in peace and in harmony up here, according to Moses' vision, for 40 days. But guess who's spying out their nakedness in the background? That's old boy. He's spying. He's at the edge of the garden. He's at the edge, at the entrance of the garden, coming in. He's spying. Now this happens after 40 days.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
See? And then we come over here, and then we see him, you know, making a play on Eve. You know, so forth and so on. And then when that happened, they see when the transgression happened, they both died in their consciousness. The S-U-N,
right,
which is synonymous with the S-O-N, the earthly son of Yahweh, who was Adam, they're both going down together.
Right.
That's why we have the colors here. The red sun, the colors, that just look at sunset sometimes. You'll probably, on certain days, you'll see all three of these colors. That represents a veil. Why? Because see, over here, the veils are open. The man was one with Yahweh. Mm-hmm. But now over here, a partition now has been set up. Mm-hmm. And the man is now cut off from Yahweh by a veil. See, he doesn't have direct communication.
That's right.
Doesn't mean Yahweh is God. Just now there's a partition.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
There's a partition now. See, it used to be he'd come to Yahweh, but now he's at Yahweh's pleasure. See, Yahweh said, I'll come to you, I'll call us, what about you? And so now that's the blue, purple, and scarlet, draw a line. That's like the second departmental veil. Okay? And then we come down here, and we said that they were 40 days according to Moses' vision, and here we got this angel here, you know, he's showing them the exit, you know. He said, I don't care where you're going, but you got to get the hell up out of here, you know. And you got a flaming sword here. And it's exhibiting a lot of light. Why? Just draw a line. Yeah, seven branch lampstand. And it was told to the man that he would have to work by the sweat of his face for his bread.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Bread.
Draw a line. Here's the bread. And that angel, see, the angel is the one that's interceding because he's blocking their way. He's in, their way into the garden. See, and it is also an incense. Okay, and just coming on down here, and here's Adam. See, because here's the angel, it's the spirit. Yeah. the spirit, I draw a line, cup of holding with olive oil. Also here with the migratory church, there was an angel in that cloud.
Right.
Yeah, angels around there are always around there somewhere, in the holy place. You know, you keep looking. And then he's working by the sweat of his face. In my ear, here he is, working by the sweat of his face. I draw a line. See? Here's the water of the Red Sea. Here's the water of the brazen labor. And then he died to mock the man Adam. First he died in his consciousness. Then he died of natural physical death 930 years later. That's why this black ball is here. And here's we have the word death here. Here's your dog death. And it's all to sin and sacrifice. Now that's just how easy that is. And that's all you, and see, the best way to even look at it is to really read the story. Because the clues will be in the stories themselves. See, and it will show you, and it will leap out at you. Let's go over here. This plate here, a lot of people really don't understand this plate. They really don't. Because it's different, and it's not on the 40 plate chart, but though in our little exercise we do include it. It's plate 41. It's in our little exercise. But this plate here is called spiritual temple plate. What this plate is an illustration of the operation of the Holy Spirit in a vessel. That's what this is an illustration of. And this is elementary. But a lot of people don't know this. And yet this is supposed to be elementary. But we'll read it for you. Dr. Kinley so graciously did explain it to us in his textbook. It's in the fourth volume.
Page 16.
What page is it?
16.
Page 16 in the fourth volume? Okay.
Volume 4, page 16.
Let's see here. I don't know if we want to read the whole thing. Let's see. Who is? Let's see. Okay, that's okay, I'm not gonna do that. Go down to page 17. Go down to page 17. Yeah, what's it in? Page number 2, the entering from the out, yeah. Read from that part right there, because that's the part that's germane. That's what I want. I almost went on a tangent there. All right, I need you to zoom in. Show them what I'm talking about, Izzy. You're going to read?
Volume 4, page 17, in page 32E, at the Last Supper.
No.
Last paragraph.
No. Down at the bottom.
Okay.
Bottom.
In page number 2.
Uh-huh.
The entering in from the outer court to the holy place, 2E to 2C, through the first veil, 2D, represent Yahshua. The door, as he said, I am the door.
Right here. This is Dr. Kennedy explaining this plate. Read.
By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved.
Mm-hmm.
In the holy place, plate 2C of the true spiritual temple, it shows
the true spiritual temple. That's he's talking about this plate. Okay, read.
It shows the functioning of Elohim as high priest in the temple of our body.
Mm-hmm.
As the illustration, as the illumination of our heart by the spirit of Elohim, Holy Spirit, as Yahshua said, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in the darkness, but shall have light of life. As compared to the candlestick shown in plate 1C, next is illustrated the nourishment of our inner man being fed by the words of Yahweh, according recorded in the law, for man doth not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of Yahweh Elohim doth man live. As compared to the priest eating of the shoe bread shown in plate 1C, next is illustrated the intercession made within us by the Spirit of Elohim, our Holy Spirit. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, not by vain repetitions said on a rosary or words written in a so-called prayer book, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered, as compared to the incense offered on the altar of incense during the hours of prayer, as shown in plate 1C. See article of prayer. In plate 32C, plate 16, is illustrating the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost, writing the law of the Spirit in the heart and mind, establishing the true spiritual body. 37C, plate 16, is illustrated the forms of religious apostasy and shown as Mystery Babylon, composed of Roman Catholics, Protestants, Jews, and others, having a form of godliness by their own righteousness, which is of the law of works, but denying the power thereof, the Yahweh, from such turn away. This satanic spirit of Satan himself incarnated in a man, as stated by John in Revelation 13:17-18, and that no man might buy or sell save he that has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name.
Okay, I think unless it's anything else, because I want to concentrate on that spiritual temple plate. If there's anything else that...
And for the number of the beast?
Get down to where it says in plate 2A.
In plate 2A and also 32A, page 16, is illustrated Elohim, who having entered through the veil of his flesh.
The veil of his flesh, that's right here. See, this word says glorification here. Mm-hmm. Through the veil of his flesh, that we read that when he died, there was a rending of the veil in the temple.
Right.
See? All right, so now here he is. Keep reading.
Parentheses, Yahshua. Into glorification is now sitting upon his throne in the heavenly Jerusalem, being made a king and high priest at the order of Melchizedek, having established by his blood the new covenant or testament in our heart and minds by the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
This was prefigured in the most holy place, plate 1A, with the invisible presence of Yahweh in the cloud above the mercy seat, on the Ark of the Covenant between the wings of the cherubim, representing the throne of Yahweh, having the Ten Commandment Law written on tables of stone, which were placed within the Ark of the Covenant. Warning to the true people of Yahweh, remember, there is no place for correction or repentance to be found for Satan and his angels, incarnated in physical bodies. They must be cast out of those possessed with these satanic spirits by the true ministers of Yahweh Elohim. Satan and his angels are reserved to the day of judgment to be punished.
Okay, good enough. Now, this is called spiritual temple play. As I said, this is an illustration of the operation of the Holy Spirit in a vessel.
Right.
Okay, this is what's happening in you. See? All right, now, a correlation I could probably pull out from here, because I know, I see this play sometimes, and I hear people get up and talk about it. This is a pet peeve of mine. People get up here, and I've heard it over here. I don't hear it too much anymore, but I used to hear people get up and say, in the point of view, and he's up here praying, and he's telling the Father, make them one, and you and I are one. And I'm like, no, that is not what he's saying when he's right here in the garden. That's not what he's saying. And people used to say that, and I would ask people, show me where he says that. I mean, he can show me where he said it, but he wasn't in the Garden of Gethsemane when he said that. Because when he said that, something else was going on. Maybe we should read it. It's Matthew 26 chapter, maybe 26.
Holy Scripture.
Matthew 26:26.
Let me make sure it's the same page. what I want.
26, 38, I think.
26, 36. Let's try it again.
Matthew 26, 36. Then cometh Joshua with them unto a place called
Gethsemane.
And said unto the disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray yonder.
Mm-hmm.
And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then said he unto them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thy will.
Now that's what he said up here. That's what he said. Not make them one as you and I are one. I mean, he did say that, but it wasn't at the garden.
Wasn't there. Mm-hmm.
And the reason why he said that, why did he say that? He told you, this is just draw a line. Because that's what Adam said. That's what Adam said up here.
Yeah.
When Eve walked up to him and said, hey, darling, put that olive. There you go, baby. That's what Adam said. Because he looked at it and he knew. He's sitting there, he's looking right at it. He knew what's happening. He said, I said, boy. Because if you read the story, nothing happened when Eve did it. But see, because their name was Adam.
Right.
He called their name Adam.
Right.
So they both got to go down together.
Mm-hmm.
So when she took that olive, you know, said, here, honey. And Adam saw and looked at it. Read that scripture again.
And when he went a little further.
No, read that scripture again. The one you just read.
And he cometh unto the disciples and findeth them asleep.
The one we just read, the
39.
That's what I was saying.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, Oh my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me.
That's what Adam said. When he came and said, if it be possible, let this pass from me. But read.
Nevertheless. Not as I will.
But as thy will. In other words, he took the olive and he ate. And both their eyes were open, and the rest is history. But Joshua, he's the second Adam. He's got to fulfill the first one. This is happening in a garden.
Mm-hmm.
See. Keep reading. There's another part in there.
And he cometh unto the disciples and findeth them asleep, mm-hmm. and said unto Peter,
mm-hmm.
What, could ye not watch with me 1 hour?
Could you watch with me 1 hour?
Right.
Why is he saying that?
Right.
1 hour. Why is he saying that?
Right.
See, because 1 hour in prophetic time is the same as 40 years. Why? Draw a line. How long was the Israelites out here in the wilderness?
40 years.
See? How long did it rain?
40 days.
How long was Adam and Eve up in the garden according to Moses' vision?
40 days.
See, he's fulfilling.
40 days.
See? 1 hour. How do I know 1 hour is 40 years? Well, see, when you talk about time, see, prophetic time is a day for a year.
Yeah.
And a year for a day. Time with Yahweh Elohim. 1,000 years is 1 day, and 1 day is as 1,000 years. And we already have read about the day of Yahweh, which time begins and ends within. And the day of Yahweh is eternity. But for this 1 hour, see, and you guys can get a calculator if you want to. Just take 1,000 years and divide it by 24 hours in a day. The answer should come out to be about 41.1 years, which Dr. Kinley rounded it off to 40.
Yeah.
So 1 hour in prophetic time is the same as 40 years. That's why Joshua said that. See? All right, keep reading.
watch and pray that ye fall not in the test.
Mm-hmm.
The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Mm-hmm.
He went away again the second time and prayed, saying,
mm-hmm.
O my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me, except I drink it,
mm-hmm.
thy will be done.
Thy will be done. Go ahead.
And he came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy.
Mm-hmm.
And he left them and went away again and prayed the third time,
mm-hmm.
saying the same words. Then cometh he to his disciples and saith unto them, Sleep on now and take your rest. Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into hands of sinners.
Oh, okay. Now, Yahshua did that three times.
Mm-hmm.
Why did he do that three times?
Mm-hmm.
How many times did the high priest go up there on the Day of Atonement?
Three.
How many times did Moses go up this mountain?
Three.
In fulfillment, how many times did Yahshua go up a mountain?
Three times.
In fulfillment of Moses. He went up many more times than that, but in fulfillment of Moses, and we have it on the charts.
Right, yeah.
See, plain, see, you don't have to get them, I'm just calling it out. Let's see, plain 29, 30, and 31.
Right.
Those three plates there represent Yahshua the Messiah fulfilling Moses' three trips into the mount.
Right.
Okay. But now here's Yahshua. See, he's fulfilling God. I mean, you think about it, it's a work. I mean, this is a man who's fulfilled, who's performing 4,000 years of people, places, and things in the space of 33 and a half years. Now, if that's not a miraculous work, I don't know what is. I can't do that like that. And neither can you. Okay? But I wanted to bring that out just to show the correlation here, you know, because he's fulfilling Adam up here.
Right.
And see, and he said, and he told his disciples to sleep. Well, what happened to Adam?
He
died in their consciousness. In other words, he went to sleep.
Like
in fact, mankind went to sleep for 4,000 years.
Yeah.
Right. So Yahshua come along.
Mm-hmm.
See?
Mm-hmm.
And see, there was an angel up here that escorted him out. I think what I want is Luke, the 21st chapter. Okay, it might be the 22nd chapter. Start with 39. 22:39.
Okay, 22:39. 22:39.
Mm-hmm.
And he came out and went as he was wont to the Mount of Olives,
mm-hmm.
and his disciples also followed him.
Mm-hmm.
And when he was at the place, he said unto them, Pray that ye enter not into temptation.
Mm-hmm.
And he was withdrawn from them about a stone cast, and kneeled down and prayed, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me, nevertheless, my will, but thine.
This is echoing what we read over in Matthew, okay, but read.
But thine be done.
Mm-hmm.
And there appeared an angel unto him from heaven.
There appeared an angel unto him from heaven. Why does an angel have to appear here from heaven? Read.
Strengthening him.
Uh-huh.
And being in an agony, he prayed more earnestly. And his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling down to the ground.
All right. So an angel appeared unto him and just sweat falling like great drops of blood. Why? Well, draw a line. Because he's fulfilling Adam.
Right.
There's an angel appearing back here, right?
Right.
See, why? Because there's an angel back here that escorted the man out of the garden.
Right.
So if an angel kicked the man out, then you got to come down here and see where an angel let the man back in. Because it doesn't say anything about the angel over here having a sword. Which means that he let the man back into it.
Right, okay.
See the point? He's fulfilling, he's the second Adam, see, he's the propitiation of our sin. He's the one, see, we fell in Adam, but we're going to be redeemed in Adam.
Yeah.
The second Adam.
Yeah.
See? And it was like great swaps, drops of blood, sweat like great drops of blood, well, on his forehead, well, draw a line. Where did Adam die at? He died in his consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
bread from the sweat of the brow.
See? All these things, as Dr. Kim would say, and he did say, you must use these correlations. You must engage these charts. Because this is the vision.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what he expounded upon. See, you must, and otherwise, his quote is, you must use these correlations. Otherwise, you must remain a skeptic.
Right.
And see, and that's what has happened in IDMR. There's a lot of skeptics. Because
mm-hmm.
they've gone on and started preaching other things. Because mm-hmm. they never took the time to truly investigate what Dr. Kelly said or talked. Mm-hmm. They didn't understand it.
Right.
And because they didn't, said, well, let's just try this, or let's go this, or let's do that. And most people just went along with it. You know? I even did on certain things, but then after a while, Yahweh had to turn me back around. I said, wait a minute, that's not why you came to this. You came here because you were interested about a pattern, a universal pattern of the universe, you know, that a universal spirit pattern that controls everything. And to this day, I haven't read any other book, and I do read. I read other stuff, because I've often said this, if I can find something better than what I'm believing in right now, I'll take it. I'm coming up on 43 years. I ain't found nothing better yet.
Mm-hmm.
That's serious. And I've looked at them all because in here it teaches you to look at everything. Because that's according to our aims to investigate everything. I checked them all out.
Right.
You know, Islam, Buddhism, Christianity, I checked them all out. Mystic arts, I used to dabble in all of that. Occult sciences, I checked all that stuff out. Doesn't compare to what this is about. I haven't found anything better. Okay? Let's do something. Again, these charts, this chart here, this elementary chart, is the basis for all of these charts. You understand this chart, you'll understand them all. Plain and simple. The founder would tell you that. Because this is your basic building block. See if I could do something. Bring up. Thirty-four and 35. What little time I have left. Because see, a lot of times people go up on the top, but they don't never, you know, they'll go to the bottom. So I'm having this up because I don't feel like bending over. You know, plus you'll shoot me, you know, in such a way like, you know, cut me off at my, you know. All right. I picked these two plates because, okay, this plate, let's see, this plate here happens to be, this plate right here, the conversion of the Gentiles, okay? Now, I picked these two plates because generally, when you begin to study these plates and these charts, you'll begin to see, especially on the 40-plate chart, that they're all correlated with each other. That's no problem. They're all correlated with each other because it's all by the pattern. However, there are certain plates that do have more of an affinity to each other. You know, they go into each other or they have an affinity. Like, for example, I would say like plate 23, which is the Abrahamic plate, and plate 27, which is the conception, birth, and flight plate of Yahshua Messiah, have an affinity. Because they both talk about, you know, the birth. You know, birth of Isaac and birth of Yahshua. One is a type of the other. Okay? Now here, these two plates. This is the conversion of the Gentiles, and this is the resurrection we confirm. This story starts here in the most holy place. Maybe we should get that. I think it's Acts, is it the 9th chapter?
Nine and one?
Maybe not quite nine, because we don't have that much time. I'm trying to expedite, But I will try to get to, let's see. No, it's not 9 and 1, it's 10 and 1. All right. I want you to start with 10 and 9. Now, as a prelude to this, Cornelius, who was a Gentile,
right,
a soldier for that matter, a centurion in the Italian band, all right, was truly interested in this doctrine. In fact, he was the man who had met Yahshua in the flesh. Because he was the one who was, you know, when he came to Yahshua and said, well, my servant is sick. And, you know, and I want you to heal him. And so Yahshua said, well, take me to him, I'll go there. And the man said, no, that's all right. You ain't gonna go nowhere. I'm a man of authority, you know. In other words, when I say do something, it gets done. I can tell, you know, you're a man of authority. All you gotta do is say, you know, just say the word and I know it gets done. I think the kids today call it real, recognizing real.
Right. You know? Oh, okay.
You know, because he was a man of authority and he recognized Yahshua as a man of authority.
Yeah.
And so he just said, well, look, you know, like, you ain't got to come to my house, man. You just say the word, and I know it'll be done. Because I'm like that. You know, when I tell my, you know, when I give it all, I say, do this. It, you know, there's no long, drawn-out arguments. And I'm like, it gets done. Okay? Because I'm an authority. And I can say, I can see you. You are a man of authority. Mm-hmm. So just say the word, and it'll get done. See, that was Cornelius. So now here we got Cornelius. He's going to come and meet up with Peter. And so now here we have Peter awaiting Cornelius' arrival. 10 and 9.
On the morrow, as they went on their journey and drew nigh unto the city, Peter went up upon the housetop to pray about the sixth hour.
Mm-hmm.
And he became very hungry and would have eaten. But while they made ready, he fell into a trance and saw heaven open and a certain vessel descending upon him,
mm-hmm,
as if had been a great sheet fastened at the four corners and let down to the earth.
All right, now Peter, let's look at this by the pattern. Peter's on top of the housetop.
Yeah.
See, that's like, draw a line. That's like the most holy place.
Yeah.
All right, the pattern, that's like the most holy place. All right, and now a sheet came down. Why a sheet? Draw a line.
Yeah.
It's like the second departmental veil.
Yeah.
Read.
Wherein were all manner of four-footed beasts of the earth, and wild beasts, and creeping things, and fowls of the air. And there came a voice to him, Rise, Peter, kill and eat. But Peter said, Not so, Yahweh, for I have never eaten anything that is common or unclean.
Okay, so now these beasts on the sheet, on the veil, represented these forbidden food. And you know, I just saw something while I was up here, because he was talking about the beast. I just draw a line over here. Didn't that beast came out of the ark up here? And wasn't that beast on the field up here? See, yeah, it just goes on and on. And so now here, Peter sees this, all right, and seeing, look, he's saying, not so, sire, because nothing unclean or uncommon is in my mouth, but read.
And the voice spake unto him again the second time.
Uh-huh.
What Yahweh hath cleansed, that call not thou common.
I agree.
This was done thrice.
It was done thrice. Why thrice? Oh, gee whiz. How many times the high priest went up here? How many times Moses went up that mountain? You understand what I'm saying? This is all correlative.
Yeah.
Continue.
And this was done thrice, and the vessel received up again into heaven.
Uh-huh.
Now while Peter wondered what this vision which he had seen should mean,
mm-hmm,
behold, the men which were sent from Cornelius had made inquiry of Simon's house and stood before the gate,
mm-hmm,
and called and asked for the Simon which was surnamed Peter were lodged there.
Mm-hmm.
While Peter thought of the vision, the Spirit said unto him, Behold, three men seek thee. Arise therefore, get thee down and go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them.
Okay, now I need to expedite this. Get down to, I think, maybe like the 44th verse.
44. While Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Spirit fell on all of them which heard the word.
Mm-hmm.
And they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because on other nationalities also was poured out the gift of the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify Yahweh. Then answered Peter, Can any man forbid water that he should not be immersed which have received the Holy Spirit as well as we?
Now let's look at this. See, now the same thing that happened to these Gentiles happened to the Jews on the day of Pentecost, okay?
Right.
Tongues of fire, why fire? Well, come over here. All right, lampstand. All right, and Peter's standing up in the midst. Why? Because he's the one interceding. Altar of incense. And the words that Peter speaks, their spirit and their life, that would be like the life, like the bread. It's all correlated. Continue.
And he commanded them to be immersed in the name of Yahshua.
Uh-huh.
Then prayed them him to tarry certain days.
Okay, now I need to get you, let's see. I need to get to, let's see, is it the 12th chapter of Acts?
Acts 12. Now about that time Herod the king stretched forth his hands to vex certain of the congregation, and he killed James the brother of John with the sword.
Now that's this illustration right here. This is Herod Agrippa the first. Herod Agrippa the first is the grandson of Herod the Great. Okay, and he was appointed king by the Romans. Mm-hmm. All right. So if you ever get this, I haven't watched it in a while, and when I do, I even take a day out to watch this whole series. It's like 13 parts, but it's a series called I, Claudius. All right, and it's really good. And it's really a true story about the emperors of Rome. It's a dramatization about the first three emperors of Rome, the first four emperors, well, five actually, all the way up to Nero. And in it, the Herod family were really good friends with the emperor. And they even in the dramatization, they even ask about, you know, they even inquire about this Yahshua, this Jesus Christ, you know. And, you know, because he was, somebody, Yahshua was around at that time.
Right.
Okay. And the Herod family, you know, they were like buddy-buddy with the Romans, with the imperial family, the Augustus Caesar, and Tiberius Caesar, and Caligula, Claudius Caesar, Nero Caesar. See, they were buddy with them. In fact, his name is Herod Agrippa. This is how buddy-buddy the Herod family is with the imperial Roman family. This guy is named after a man named Marcus Agrippa, who was the commanding battle in the, it's a very famous naval battle. It's called the Battle of Actium. And see, and this is a battle where, at that time, Octavian Caesar routed the forces of Mark Antony and Cleopatra and solidified his rule, and he became Augustus Caesar. Okay? The Herod family gave supplies to the Romans to help in this battle. Because the Herod family was ruling Palestine, you know, Judea at that time, after the period of the Maccabees. This is all this stuff that people don't study. This is the period between Malachi and Matthew, the 400 years between the book of Malachi and the book of Matthew. You know, it's the intertestamental period, you know, about how things happened during that time that sets up what happens around here when Yahshua comes on the scene. But anyway, Herod, he kills James, all right, the brother of John. See, so now look, spirit and his water and his blood. This is all in a descending.
Right.
All right, keep reading.
3, and because he saw it please the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also.
Uh-huh.
Then were the days of unleavened bread.
All right, now because it pleased the Jews, and then he killed James, he said, oh, well, shoot, let me get this guy. You know, Peter was considered, he was the head of the disciples. He was, well, no. So he grabbed Peter and put him in prison. Okay, but not knowing that this is according to Yahweh's will. See, this plate is called resurrection reconfirmed. Right. Mm-hmm. See, Peter being in prison is 10 years, and this is in AD 43, 10 years after Yahshua Messiah is the reconfirmation that Yahshua Messiah did resurrect from the grave. Okay, read.
And when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison and delivered him to four quaternions of soldiers.
Four quaternions of soldiers. Why four quaternions? What is a quad?
Four.
It's four. Draw a line. Isn't there 4 points of blood here?
Right.
Okay. Read.
Intending after Passover to bring him forth to the people.
Uh-huh.
Peter therefore was kept in prison. The prayer was made without ceasing by the congregation unto Yahweh for him.
Uh-huh.
And when Herod would have brought him forth, the same night Peter was sleeping between two soldiers.
Between two soldiers. Why between two soldiers? Mm-hmm. See, when Yahshua was crucified, what was he crucified? Was he crucified between two thieves?
Thief and robber. Uh-huh.
See?
Thief and robber.
Mm-hmm. All right, read.
Bound with two chains.
Uh-huh.
And the keeper before the door guarded the prison. And behold, the angel of Yahweh came unto him,
uh-huh.
and the light shined in the prison. And he smote Peter on the side,
uh-huh.
and raised him up, saying, arise up quickly, and his chains fell off from his hand.
Why did he smote Peter in the side? Come on, draw a line. Right here. You see this? Wouldn't he smote in the side?
Uh-huh.
See, this is resurrection reconfirmed. All right, read.
And the angel said unto him, gird thyself and bind on thy sandals. And so he did. And he saith unto him, cast thy garment about thee and follow me. And he went out and followed him, and realized not that it was true which was done by the angel, but thought he saw a vision. When they were past the first and the second ward, they came unto the iron gate that leadeth unto the city, which opened to them of its own accord.
Mm-hmm.
And they went out and passed on through one street, and forthwith the angel departed from him.
Okay, now his iron gate opened up. See, why did it do that? See, then the Red Sea back here. Then the Red Sea back here opened up for the Israelites.
Right.
See, the stone here. See, did the angel here roll that stone away?
Mm-hmm.
With Joshua? See, this is resurrection reconfirmed. Okay? Read quickly.
And they went out and passed on through one street, and forthwith the angel departed from him.
Mm-hmm.
And when Peter had come to himself, he said, Now I know with surety that Yahweh has sent his angel and delivered me out of the hand of Herod and from all the expectations of the people of the Jews. And when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Miriam, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark,
mm-hmm.
where many were gathered together praying. And as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a damsel came to hearken named Rhoda.
Mm-hmm.
And when she knew Peter's voice, she opened not the gate for gladness, but ran in and told how Peter stood before the gate.
Okay.
And they said unto her, Thou art mad. But mm-hmm. she constantly affirmed that it was even so. Then said they, It is his angel. But Peter continued knocking, and when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. But he beckoned unto them with the hand to hold their peace, declared unto them how the angel of Yahweh had brought him out of the prison.
Okay, good enough. Now, so when Peter came up and resurrected, he had to meet a woman.
Mm-hmm.
Just like Yahshua, we don't have. Here, when Yahshua came out, we got it right there. He had to meet a woman. See? He had to meet a woman. And so now, just watch this. Here's Peter right here. So when Peter, because Peter was just as, when he was down here, he was just as good as dead.
Mm-hmm.
But now here he is, he's being resurrected out. So he comes out of that, because he thought he was dreaming. See, thought, you know, sleep, you know, but then he realized, you know, oh, I'm not. And so now, he meets a woman. Why? Draw a line. Draw a line. Remember this guy over here, he was in a deep sleep down here?
Yes.
But when he wakes up,
Well,
you can even read in the book of Ruth. There's a story about Boaz after the harvest, and he's making merry, getting drunk. And then, you know, he wakes up around midnight and there's a woman at his feet. It's Ruth. See, it's all principles. See, when you go through these things, you begin to learn about principles. Because it's not about how good you can correlate. It's not about that. It's about recognizing the principles in the correlations. Because these principles are applicable to you. This is what Dr. Kimmel was trying to show us. Yes.
Was Rhoda somebody special?
Rhoda, she was just a member of the church, member of the assembly, a young lady. She was just somebody Yahweh chose to say, okay, I need you to be here when Peter gets out. You know, because this is resurrection, he's confirmed.
Yeah.
Okay? She's being operated by the law of the Spirit like everything else. Which time I got? Let me say something about this part on the chart. AD 52, Acts 15 chapter. Quickly.
Acts 15, and certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren and said, Except you be circumcised after the manner of Moses,
mm-hmm.
you cannot be saved.
Read.
When therefore Saul and Barnabas had no small dissension and disputation with them, they determined that Saul and Barnabas and certain other of them should go up to Jerusalem unto the apostles and elders about this question.
Mm-hmm.
And being brought on their way by the congregation, they passed through Phoenicia and Samaria, declaring the conversion of the nations. And they caused great joy unto all the brethren. And when they were come to Jerusalem, they were received of the congregation and of the apostles and elders, and they declared all things that Yahweh had done with them. But there were certain of the sect of the Pharisees which believed, saying that it was needful to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses.
Mm-hmm.
And the apostles and elders came together for to consider of this matter.
Now let's stop and think from this. You know, there were certain people who believed. There were Pharisees who believed that Yahshua resurrected. But they also still believed that you still had to do carnal ordinances.
Mm-hmm.
And here, we don't have time for maybe another lecture, we can do it later. I've done it before. This is the origin of the Roman Catholic Church.
Right.
The beginnings of it here. Because these folks kept on. See, they didn't go away after this meeting. See, now Peter, he had to rise up. Get to the part where Peter rises up quickly, but we're out of time.
7, and when there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them, Men and brethren, you know how that a good while ago Yahweh made choice among us, that the nations by my mouth should hear the word of the glad tidings and believe. And Yahweh which knoweth the hearts bear them witness, giving them the Holy Spirit, even as he did unto us, and put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. Now therefore, why tempt you Yahweh to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear? But we believe that through the grace of Yahshua the Messiah, we shall be saved, even as they.
Now Peter stood up, that would be like the going off in an instant, because he's interceding. See, and he's speaking. The words he speaks, their spirit, their life. That's right. Like the bread. See, and through his words of the Holy Spirit, they are being enlightened about the matter. The lampstand. Quickly.
12. Then all the multitude kept silence and gave audience to Barnabas and Saul, declaring what miracle and wonders Yahweh had wrought among the nations by them.
All right, good enough. Now, when Peter did that, that was a rending of a veil or a partition between Jew and Gentile, because they still have one. Because these folks came up and said, well, the Gentiles got to do the same thing we did. We had to go through. And Peter saying, no, they don't. Yeah. See? So see, look here. We started over here with this plate. We went down, rented the veil. Between, see, Peter's doing the same thing on two plates. Rented the veil here, come over here, then we went down to here. And then we came over here. And that was descending. Now we're ascending. And here's Peter doing the same thing again, renting the veil again. See? Alright, showing forth that, see, that the Gentiles were able recipients of that promise that was given to Abraham. That through Abraham, all families of the earth would be blessed. I must say this was a different way I did the elementary chart this year. But I hope that, at the very least, you can see the importance of correlations as far as understanding these charts. Now, some folks may not agree with it, you know, that's okay with me. But I've seen what Dr. Kinley has talked about, and I know that it does work. See, all right? And that when you practice these things, see, and what it's supposed to do, that Dr. Kinley had hope, if he would hope that you would facilitate reading the scriptures. He was saying this, and said, man, you got a Bible, you got a book. Try reading it sometime. Because see, the thing about it with him, see, he was a bibliomaniac before he received this vision and revelation. But when he received his vision and revelation about this pattern, he said the Bible didn't read the same anymore. So when he went back into the Bible, he looked at it with a different perspective, with a different, you know, set of eyes, different, you know. In other words, he looked at it through the power of the Holy Spirit. Because, see, your knowledge and understanding of this tabernacle pattern is the Holy Spirit.
Right.
And if anybody says otherwise, they simply don't know. They just don't. And they just lying. And they either don't know, or they're lying, or they're actively trying to deceive you. Or, you know, because that's what Dr. Kinley preached. We read it. You understand this pattern. See, you understand this. You're living. You know, you'll live throughout eternity with those who hear his voice from heaven. And I ain't talking about the atmospheric heaven.
Right.
I'm out right here. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
When they crossed into Canaan land, did the waters part again? And where would I find it?
That's in the book of Joshua, the third or the fourth chapter.
River Jordan,
where they had to take rocks out. That's why when Yahshua was in the wilderness of Judea and the Satan tried to tempt him, he said, well, can you turn these rocks into bread? Mm-hmm. They weren't just ordinary stones, you know. Mm-hmm. Those were rocks that the Israelites had taken out of the middle of the Jordan River when it had divided, and it had set there as a landmark.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. See, Yahshua knew that, and the devil knew that too. He said, well, here's some of these stones. We can turn them into bread. Yeah, man, come on. You know, don't try to tempt Yahweh. Okay? Because that's how Dr. Kinley explained it. What those stones were. Okay? I think we're out of time.
Yep,
any other questions? We're going to continue our winner series. I think you ought to get up and say something live for at least 2 minutes, maybe. But what we want as far as the kind of, you know, so I'm gonna let our dean do that. So thank you very much for being so patient.
First of all, I want to thank our guests for coming to visit with us. Hopefully something was said that inspired you to come back and study with us again. We're going to continue on our winter series, as we do. We have some winter lectures every Sunday about a specific topic, and we inspire the assembly to participate and get an opportunity to stand up and to study and to learn a particular subject matter. To take away some of those jitters, because some folks say that they're not a speaker. Everybody's a speaker, and you all, everybody has a testimony. So we want to inspire you to take a lecture. Doesn't matter if it's 5 minutes, 10 minutes, whatever. The point is that the effort was made to learn something about Yahweh and His purpose. And what I learned years ago when I was growing up in class is that find one thing that is your passion, that you enjoy. You expound in that, because the entire purpose of planning Yahweh is laid down in that one principle. Because we're not down here trying to learn types and shadows. What we're trying to do is to where you become conscious of who you are. Learning about types and shadows ain't going to do you any good until you take the principles of the charts and put them in you. That's the reality, is to wake you up and let you find out who you are. So we're going to continue this. We're going to try to post a schedule sometime this week. And for those of you who have picked the topic, let me know. Otherwise, I will give you one. Anyway, I want to turn it over to our moderator.
Well, I truly thank the Father for allowing us to hold class this morning. And we hold classes every Tuesday, Friday, from 7:30 to 9:30, Sunday mornings from 11 to 1. Fourth Sunday of every month, we have a Spanish class from 9:30 in the morning to 10:45. Like I said, next Sunday we will continue with our winter series of lectures. I think next week the dean has a topic he will talk about. So come back again and study with us. Bring your friends and all your enemies, and all donations will be accepted by Attorney Dr. Lloyd Lawrence. And if you want a copy of today's lecture, see please Kenaway after class and stand for the doxology.
We have a business meeting next week.
Yeah, we have a business meeting next Sunday at 10 o'clock in the morning. Not 10 on 10, 10 o'clock. Okay. Now, Tim, that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of His glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, to Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, for our glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever, let us all say,
Hallelujah.
How are you doing?
Where you from? You from around the area?
No.
Okay. You born and raised in LA?
Cool.
Okay. I was born and raised in LA all my life. So how do you, when you come out this way? Okay. I don't know when you come out, when you migrate. Okay.
You live in the area?
He was a what?
All white.
Oh, no, yeah, Edomite.
Yeah, he was a converted Jew. His family was, yeah, that's true.
And so Antipas, the Herod Antipas was his son, not grandson.
No, Herod Antipas. Herod Antipas was his son. This is, he was Agrippa. He was Agrippa.
Oh, okay.
He's a grandson. Herod killed his father because he thought his father was trying to plot against him for the throne.
Oh, okay.
Killed his father. And so his father sent him away to Rome.
Yeah.
And he grew up in the imperial household. This guy, that's why he knew Caligula and Tiberius. The Herod family, they're like this, you know, for at least, oh my goodness, almost 100 years maybe. The family, who was the first one? Antipater? And it was Antipater, yeah. That was the first Herod. He was their father.
Were they Jews?
They were Edomites, but they were converted to be Jews.
Yeah. All right. Okay. All right. I'll take care. All right. We'll see you.
Probably. Yeah.
Tuesday.
Okay.
I must say I was proud of Will. He didn't go crazy. I was proud of you. I really was. I'm serious. I am, yeah. You did exactly what I wanted you to do. Exactly. Exactly what I mean.
Let's get the trash out.
All your knowledge of where you can learn up to this point.
No.
I need to make one copy. All right. And we're not talking about the knowledge of this world.
Good morning.
Happy New Year.
You too.
Spirit. Because we talk about